Hi, this is Kevin C. Mason from JackMonkey Games, creator of Roll vs. Roll and Twitter geek extraordinaire, and you're listening to Legends of Tabletop.
Oh, that was fantastic. Welcome, everybody, to episode 90 of the Legends of Tabletop podcast. I was filling out the thing today, and I said, holy crap, we're sitting at 90 episodes already. It's crazy.
90. Okay, at some point, you have to accept the, you have to get a new feat now. Okay, so yeah. Now that you've done this, you have to get a new feat. You know, you probably should go and I would take extra listeners and then also get a couple levels in. You're already doing the live. Okay, but that would give you a +2 to new listeners. And I think you're good.
I'm gonna take the backstory of Master Editor.
There you go. Yeah. After a while, you start to, you can identify ums in waveform. You go, there's an um.
Yep, absolutely. So we have a thing on the front here called Something Cool. We'll jump into this thing. So what cool stuff do you have going on these days?
So right now, we're moving house. I don't know if you call that cool in, I think it's 43 Celsius here right now. Don't ask me in Fahrenheit, but it's freaking hot. Mm-hmm. What's really cool about this is that I'm going from this tiny little shack of a studio. If you guys have watched my YouTube video, it's literally a closet. And it's now, I get this extra long two-car garage for my studio. Nice. And my wife, who is, by the way, just as geeky as I am, goes, oh, we can put the game table here, and we can put your canvases over here. You can set up your server here. And I'm just like, oh, my God, this is fantastic. So that's really cool. I'm very happy about that because I've got a lot of projects coming up. So,
well, that's good to hear. All right. Maybe we'll talk about that a little bit later. But you're actually from the States here. You're...
So I apologize for anyone who's expecting an Australian accent, being the fact that I'm moving to a place called Emu Plains. Emu Plains. I still can't say the place that I'm living in. So here I'm exotic because I have that California accent. I'm actually from Sacramento, California. We moved out here about 7 years ago, and it's pretty awesome. Australia is a pretty awesome place to be.
What was the impetus? So
my wife, her best friend in high school married an Aussie. And so she's been coming back and forth for the last 20 years. And when she couldn't find work being a copyright lawyer in the States because of the GFC crash, we were thinking, Australia. Free healthcare. It's kind of nice there. And they're looking for lawyers, and they pay bank for technicians. Okay, let's go. And fortunately, because she's got a Juris Doctorate and environmental degree and all these other things in front of her name, they said, yeah, come on over. So we arrived here. I had showed up as a permanent resident, took two steps on into Sydney and went, wow, this is cool. And I love it. Oh, cool. Absolutely love it.
But the spiders are like this big, right? I mean, bigger than your head.
You have no idea. Okay. The first time I saw a spider, I'm sitting here and I walk into my friend's kitchen and I scream like a child. I'm like, ah! Okay, this thing was freaking huge. It was so big, I was expecting some hobbits to come take it on, okay? It was that big. And then my friend comes in thinking, okay, what's going on? You know, has he cut himself? Has he fallen down? What's happened? And he looks down and goes, oh, mate, that's a baby. And look, the cat already got to it and ate half of it. And I'm thinking, what? So, and by the way, it was a huntsman spider, which is perfectly harmless. In fact, if you see a huntsman spider, you should let it do its thing. They're actually pretty friendly. They eat the spiders that can kill you. So, you know, feed them a couple flies, you know, a couple cockroaches. You know, they don't eat much. They don't bite much. They scare the hell out of you when you're in the kitchen, you know, but other than that, they're pretty good.
Right. That's crazy. Well, so it turned out well for you guys then. You don't have to answer this one, but then I just wonder, you know, being, you know, from the States here, but being a resident there, do you vote generally in the elections here? Or
yes, I do.
Okay, good.
Yes, I do. Because I tell you, I became a global citizen when it was during the last election. The election before that. Okay, it was for Obama's reelection. Regardless of where people stand on their view on him, okay, this was purely the reaction I got from an Australian, okay? An Australian who served in Vietnam alongside Americans, okay? So we're in what is called an RSL. An RSL is the equivalent of a USO. So it caters towards retired military staff for their service. And all proceeds are supposed to go, it's a nonprofit. It's kind of like a nonprofit casino bar kind of thing where all the profits go towards veterans. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, sounds good.
So I'm sitting here and I'm drinking my beer, by the way, Australian beer, really good. And this Australian guy next to me, he's watching the election, and this guy, he's pretty old. He's pretty old. And he's like, he was so happy that Obama had won. Now, I asked him, so what's going on? He says, well, I'm afraid that the other guy is going to take us to war. And he says, you know something? When Americans die, Australians die, because Australians have America's back. And at that point, I was like, oh my gosh, here's all these Australians watching what happens in America because they're concerned about what's going on. And at that point, I became a global citizen. I'm going to become a dual citizen next year.
Oh, cool.
This year I'm going to be a dual citizen, so I'll get to vote in both places, and hopefully make a little bit of a difference in my direction, which I won't go into. If you're on my Twitter feed, you'll figure it out. But
sure.
I'm not shy.
Yeah, typically, we don't, engage in politics on the show because that's a losing battle. But I wonder about it because, it's not often that, you get to talk to somebody who's, from the U.S. living somewhere else permanently. So I just, figure beg the question to, it's interesting for me to find out, whether or not it's just like, I'm not there, I don't care, or, I'm totally invested.
It's very interesting because Australians actually watch American politics like a hawk. In fact, it's not uncommon to encounter an Australian who knows more about American politics and American laws than they do about Australian laws and politics. It's because America does have such an impact on the rest of the world. Not saying that, Australia is better in that regards, because Australia has got some crazy, let's see, I've been here for 7 years and there's been, I have yet to see an entire, a prime minister go through a full term. It's pretty crazy.
That's weird. Okay. All right. So you mentioned a little bit, you guys are moving, you've been through a little bit of, personal upheaval, recently. People will follow you on Twitter or are aware of it.
Yeah.
You got laid off, you're, moving, across town and all. So how are you holding up? How are you guys doing?
It's been pretty tough. So the day before I signed the lease on this new place, my entire team got pulled into the into a conference room, and we're talking to the global the person who's globally in charge of our department, and said, "It's not because you guys are not, you know, are not performing properly, but it's purely a financial decision, and we're gonna let all of you go."
Man. You know, and it's coming, right? When the whole group gets pulled in, you're like, oh, this is not good.
Oh, yeah. See, we were walking in. I'm like, HR's there. It's a red wedding. And so we just had one, like not too long ago. There was another, we call it the red wedding because they wine and dine you the day before. And so we're expecting this whole, you know, it's like HR's there. It's like, HR's never in these meetings. And I'm like, okay, here it comes. And I was right. It's a bit stressful. Fortunately, we're in a spot where the payout was pretty nice. And we're at a spot now where the rent is much cheaper where we're moving.
That's good.
And my wife, who also was made redundant, but fortunately, they relocated her into another department. So she's going through her other stress. It's not going to affect us financially, but it's pretty crazy right now. So,
to say the least.
Yeah.
That happened to me. My first official lab job out of college. I worked there for about a year. You know, getting ready to buy a house and everything. Just, you know, we signed the papers and everything, and it was the same thing. Company that I worked for was like a subsection of a larger company. Larger company got bought. We got shut down and, yeah. You know, did unemployment. And then, you know, I was working like 6 part-time jobs and, you know, was eventually lucked into a place where I was at for like 17 years after that, doing the same kind of work. So it sucks.
Yeah. Well, this is going to give us enough opportunity, though, because the problem I had with getting role versus role out was that I was always working. I didn't have the time to do the work. And with our other projects coming out soon, I now have taken a look at our timeline and went, I could do this in half the time now because I actually have the time to do the work. So we're going to start working on more of a production schedule. So that will be interesting.
Okay. Well,
that will be interesting.
Good. All right. So, you know, superheroes all have their origin stories and how they got their powers and all that kind of stuff. What's mm-hmm. your gaming origin story? How did you get sucked into the hobby?
Okay. So I have always been this kid with great imagination. In fact, that was considered, I had so much imagination as a kid, my father saw that as a disadvantage, and that I had my head in the clouds and that sort of thing. So one day we're up in the mountains with on the coast, and I was 10? And I was climbing on this tree. We had a bunch of other families that are all at this kind of trailer park kind of thing. And I fell and landed on barbed wire.
Ooh.
So 10 stitches, you know, as a kid, pretty traumatic. But now, in the middle of summer, I'm not allowed to go swimming. My stepmother became helicopter parent, so I'm stuck in the house. And this older kid said, "Hey, I got this game." And he pulls out this red box. And it was D&D, and it was the most amazing thing ever. So I became absolutely obsessed. And the problem with being a broke kid is that you can't quite go and afford to buy a box set like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I went and bought a 30-sided dice because that was the coolest looking one. And it was also cheap because no one could figure out what to do with it. So I had a 30-sided die. That was it. And now what? So I got a notebook and started writing down rules. And so the first, I actually had not played D&D other than that first time for almost 5 to 6 years later, but I gamed every day. And it was this home, it was this organic homebrew that me and my buddies put together, and it was an absolute blast.
That's cool. Did were there other things that you got involved with at that time, or just sort of like that homebrew kind of system?
Well, we did the homebrew for a while. Then I discovered Shadowrun. I also did BattleTech and a little bit of D&D. Did a lot of anything I could get my hands on from West End Games. Anything at West End Games, I was the total West End Games fanboy. So be it Star Wars, Indiana Jones, Masterbook, Torg.
Mm-hmm.
Torg. In fact, I even still have a Torg deck around here somewhere. In a box. It's in a box somewhere. Yeah,
everything's in boxes.
So I did a lot of that. And I found that I liked playing games where not everyone knew the rules. Because I hated dealing with rules with lawyers, especially if they knew the game better than I did. So if it was an obscure game system, I would pick it up, which is why I picked up Shadowrun. And I found that running games like that, it was it would tend to be more roleplay heavy because no one knew the rules. So yeah. Because you didn't know the rules, you didn't know how to bump this stat to get this bonus to do extra damage in case of a left-handed goblin who is temporarily blinded by a storm giant who has this cold, you really start to do some pretty heavy role-playing. And some of my friends didn't like that, but eventually I found a really good group that just loved it.
Yeah. I've gotten into more of the role play aspect of it as I've gotten older. Like, it's still fun to, you know, swing a sword and hack up monsters or, you know, pick the locks and do all that kind of stuff. But like we were talking before we got on air, the Fear Itself game is so RP heavy. I mean, you know, there'll be sessions where we might not even roll dice at all. Because it's just all story and character interaction.
Well, and that's it. You know, I poke fun at murder hobos all the time on Twitter. And though I want to put out that I actually don't mind murder hobos if everyone's on the same page.
Sure.
Okay, I have no problems with an absolute, you know, natural born killers murder spree. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. As long as that's what everyone else is on who says, hey, yeah, that would be great. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. It's when you've got a mixed group and you've got polarizing ideals. So you've got someone who wants to go and talk about the relationships between the various characters and you know, want to influence the NPCs into getting into a relationship with somebody else, and the other person's like, yeah, let's stab him.
Yeah.
That's because it's not fun for either one. As long as everyone's on the same page, then go for it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one of the reasons why I do poke fun at murder hobos because, well, it's fun. I've had a couple really bad murder hobos in some of my previous games. And it's kind of caused some trouble for some plots that I'd spent hours and hours writing.
Yeah, that happens. Well, and that's a little bit too. I mean, like when you're getting ready to sit down and start, you know, maybe a new campaign or, you know, maybe you're just running a one shot, you know, to kind of get, you know, find out what the players are looking for before you even start and see like what kind of a game are we going to run here. And you know, you kind of work out that stuff on the front end and be like, okay, I know I need to write this way because, you know, this half of the group is going to want this and this half is going to want that. Or, you know, everybody's in for, you know, murdered mayhem.
Well, one of the things that I have done is I have a spreadsheet now that I run. And when I'm running a game, first of all, I always set the expectations of what I want to do in a game. I want to say, okay, guys, this is going to be pretty heavy a role play. There will be combat. I'll try to make it so it's exciting. But for the most part, it's going to be roleplay. Or I'm going to say, roll two characters. Get two characters, get them ready, because it's going to be bloody. When you set the appropriate expectations, then everyone know that they're set and they know what kind of fun they're going to have. I have seen the murder hoboist, player turn into a heavy role player because we said immediately, okay, this is going to be a political game. We're going to be discussing concepts of, does an artificial intelligence have a soul? And because he knew that from the get-go, he was completely okay with the idea of just role-playing. Mm-hmm. Now, I threw in a whole bunch of combat to spice things up a little bit, and he thought that was even better, but he was prepared for those long-winded conversations.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, that's good. That's the way to do it, for sure.
Well, you know, you'd be surprised what you can get away with if you ask for permission first.
Yeah. Right. Well, because it's, you know, it's cooperative storytelling. I mean, you know, the players are just as much a driving factor as what's going on in the game as, you know, the story the GM wants to tell. So,
yeah. Well, it's like with the spreadsheet. What I do is that I mark down every time I give someone a point, an experience point or something for good role playing. I mark down on what is it for? Is it for comedy? Is it for them being adventurous? Is it because it was this badass battle? Was it for heavy role play? And then whoever gets the least amount of points in the session is the topic of my next game. Mm. But what I do is that part of that spreadsheet, I get an idea of what the campaign's like.
Interesting.
So I know that is what they tend to like. Tend, because I also do use the spreadsheet to realize I haven't run combat in a while. Okay, I need to throw some more combat. So I can also use it for balance to try and figure out, I mean, like all statistics, you know, it does take a little bit of interpretation.
Sure, sure. That's cool. That's interesting. When did you start JackMonkey Games, and what were you, you know, trying to accomplish when you started? Do you have a plan in mind when you, you know, decided to, you know, get everything going?
Well, so my wife is very much on, okay, put your money where your mouth is. And I was working, I've been running this homebrew called Starfall for like 20 some odd years. And I've got all these worlds in my head, and my wife's like, you need to write them down. Well, we also need funding to do that. So what we've decided we were going to do is start off one Kickstarter project, and we were going to start a concept of it, get our feet wet, see how we like it, and then use the funding from that to not only get the product out, but to start funding our next project. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the things that we've been doing with Roll versus Roll is nothing more than a setup for a product that's not going to be released in another 2 to 3 years.
All right. Long-term planning. That's good.
Long-term planning. In fact, I will let you know there's a lot of Easter eggs in the card deck that people won't realize are exactly that until after we publish the final product.
Nice.
So, now, my current players are like, oh my god, this card has this in it. That's awesome. And, you know, they're excited because they get it. They get it. And it's like there's one that even has, there's a coffee mug in one of the images that is actually an Easter egg. And it's just the saying on the coffee cup is enough to hint to a story that hasn't been published yet.
Hmm. Interesting. Is that the one with you drinking the coffee?
No, that one domesticated. Now that bit of artwork was fun because that literally was me first thing in the morning. And then I was like, I'm working on this card called Domesticated. Snap, and I took it. That was it. That was it.
Cool. The art is really, I mean, it has like a painted quality to it. I really like the art. It came out really well.
Thank you. So by nature, I am actually an artist. So, in fact, my wife sometimes argues that I should be spending more time actually doing art than gaming stuff. Oh, darn. You know, it's all about the balance. So the art with this is I take a photograph and then I actually, instead of putting it through a filter, you know, so it's not like one of these, you know, Instagram snap filters or was it Prism or whatever is the app that works now? Yeah. What I do is I actually hand paint the entire image to give it that painted feel. And then I Photoshop things into it. So like there was one image of, I'll grab a public domain image and then I tweak it to hell so it's this new creation. So for example, the one called Run Away, which is this cop running away from this giant crab. This giant crab is actually a compilation of 5 or 6 different crabs. A robot that I found, I found the legs of this robot, and then I added other pieces to it and add armor belts and, oh look, here's a gun. Okay, let me tweak this a little bit, okay? And pow, it's a new expression. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. In fact, some of the people in there are actually my friends that I've actually taken photos of them and said, hey, look, Ilya, you're now in space.
Yeah. Cool. I'm going back and forth in the chat, which is why I seem a little bit distracted. Tom's in the chat again, and he says, why not just put together some campaigns and kickstart those as a book for the, you know, for your long-term project, as opposed to sort of ramping up, just be like, okay, I'm going to, you know, set down some, you know, quick start rules or, you know, that sort of thing.
Well, what we did is Roll versus Roll was actually for that very purpose, that is to kind of test the waters of Kickstarter, because I had been listening to Kickstarter podcasts, I've read all the blogs, but I had a general idea of what I wanted to do, but I still wanted to figure out, is this even going to work? And I did run a Kickstarter campaign, which we canceled because we found out one extremely critical bit of information. And that is 90% of the people who are visiting the webpage and 90% of the backers were in the US, not Australia. We were thinking it was going to be the other way around. So when it comes to manufacturers, in order to deliver these decks, we would have to have it manufactured in China, shipped to Australia, unboxed, repackaged, and then shipped overseas again.
Jeez.
And we're looking at this and we're like, it's going to cost us 3 times the amount of a deck.
Mm-hmm.
Holy cow. So that one bit of information was enough for us to decide, okay, this is what we're going to do. The other thing is that we need some severe equipment upgrades. You've probably seen the post of my cracked computer screen.
Mm-hmm.
I'm using a 7-year-old Mac, which, when you consider that I'm actually a Mac genius, I actually no longer work for Apple, but that thing is running just because, the only reason why it's still running is because I've been cannibalizing other parts, I've, you know, got the software purring as much as I possibly can, and it just can't keep up anymore. So these Kickstarters are going to make it so we can actually afford to exist at the same time as slowly start to do the upgrades we need. That, and I find that the slow build has more impact. And I'm thinking that if I can produce like Roll versus Roll and just make that the best I possibly can, learn about this whole publishing thing, learn about distributing these products, learn about what I need to do for marketing, which, by the way, podcast advertising is a great idea. Very affordable. You know, it's things like that. Learn these things on these smaller projects, and then as we build up to these larger, have the experience necessary to not only make it work, but actually produce the best thing possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that all makes sense. So we're talking about role versus role. I will jump around mm-hmm. here to questions a little bit. What's the origin story for that? How did role versus role come about?
So I have a really large game group, which barely ever shows up at any one time because life, you know, we're all adults.
Yep.
And I had this lovely new player, and she sat down, and everyone's doing heavy role-playing, and she's staring at her character sheet, and she has no idea what to do. Hmm. She sees these numbers, there are all these strange concepts, and she was just absolutely lost. And we couldn't break her away from the character sheet. She couldn't get into character. Now, I was thinking, okay, but what happens if we were to give her something else to think about? Give her something else, a tangible goal to go towards that would force her to do some role-playing. So I came up with role versus role. And what role versus role is for those people not familiar with, it's a deck of cards. Currently, we have 40 cards, which more are in production. And what these cards have is a role-playing goal. So, for example, there might be one which is rage. So at some point, you are supposed to absolutely lose it in battle. And I'm not talking just, you know, battle cry. I'm talking kicking the body after you've annihilated it. This is the murder hobo card. Okay, you just... okay. In fact, murder hobos would have picked the pockets and moved on. You're supposed to go beyond that. Or... guilt. You know, the card where you've done something and you're supposed to role play in a way that you feel guilty for something you've done. Or debt. Debt is where you should either repay a debt or get into debt with somebody. Creating these role play hooks for the GM. Well, what happens is the GM goes, dishes out three to five cards to every player. And you look at the cards and you go, huh, well, this doesn't fit, this doesn't fit, this doesn't fit. Ooh, domesticated. Okay, I'm going to put this one in. And sometime through the game, in a subtle fashion, you're supposed to show your domestic life. You know, talk about where you keep your coffee can. You know, is your hair messed up in the morning? Talk about the, you know, do you have pets? That sort of thing. You know, what do you do when you're not adventuring? And what that does is that gives the GM those hooks. They start thinking, huh, you know, what are we going to, you know, oh, okay, well, they have a pet. You know, maybe someone steals their cat. It makes it easier for the GM and really fleshes out the characters. And it does it in a way that isn't too intrusive. You don't have to stop and talk about your character's backstory. You don't have to stop and take time away from the GM. I mean, even just looking at the cards, trying to figure out which one you want to pick, you're starting to develop your character. You're mm-hmm. starting to think, okay, how could I talk about my domestic life? Or how am I going to be an action hero? You know, what sort of crazy stunt am I going to do in this adventure? You start thinking about what would my character do? And that really fosters and provides a good environment for role-playing. In our playtesting, we had this guy go, and he took the role versus role cards, and he said his group was pretty heavily murder hobos, and he says he's never seen them role play this much, which I thought was pretty damn awesome. I wish he was recording it because I would love to have actually watched that.
Yeah. No, that's cool, and that's the best kind of feedback, right? To have that sort of a group really embrace it, just, you know, from looking at a card, just kind of get that, you know, break that nut open and just kind of get them rolling a little bit. And then, you know, a lot of times players just kind of just run with it.
Well, and that's the thing, you know, some people joke that murder hobos are a lesser form of role playing. And it's not. In most cases, it's just that there isn't enough character development for them to enjoy anything else. So right. If they develop their character, then maybe they will enjoy having that conversation with the king without stabbing him twice.
Yeah. Right. It's non-specific, so you could use role versus role in your Shadowrun game, in your D&D game, your Rogue Trader game, whatever you're playing, you can work those aspects into the story.
Yeah, we've specifically designed it so it is it's game agnostic. So I've personally tested it with Shadowrun. It worked really well. I've run it with a D6 system, which works really well. In both cases, I find that the reward for fulfilling the requirement is extra XP. Or a bonus, or you could say, okay, well, you get a bonus for this. So it leaves it open for the GM to decide what the reward is. I've heard stories of people running it in the cipher system in Numenera and giving out free ciphers for people that are doing, that complete these cards. Or extra XP, which in that game is a pretty big deal because you can use it to avoid a GM intrusion. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of good stuff there.
Sure. All right, I'm going to switch tactics here a little bit with all the mm-hmm. running around that you've been doing. Are you using coffee to kind of keep that engine running?
What's that? I got the it was like blah, 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 blah. It's Australian internet.
Oh, okay. So are you using coffee to keep your engine primed and running as you move houses and do all these crazy things?
I am a coffee addict. In fact, the first thing we did was move in a coffee pot. After the Numenera and Shadowrun books was the coffee pot. It's absolutely required there. Yeah, coffee. It's a thing. It's a thing.
Okay. Have you tried Bird's Coffee? Have you heard of it before?
I've heard of it. I can't because the import to Australia, unfortunately, though I am the exact demographic, unfortunately, it probably won't be cost effective for us, being the fact that we are in, Australia.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, I'll tell you a little bit about it so we can kind of get you jealous of us here in the States. So Birds of a Feather Coffee Company roasts unique craft coffees in small batches, so it's always fresh. I just placed an order. It was mm-hmm. roasted within a few days and sent to me absolutely fresh. When I opened up my mailbox this morning or this afternoon, I could smell the coffee. I got so excited when it came in. I'm like, oh, I know what's in here. Their signature blends showcase the amazing breadth and depth of flavors that coffee has to offer. The Morning Lark blend, for instance, is a bright, complex coffee with a lot of layers, from the structured roasted malt base to the honeyed sweetness that finishes with hints of citrus and spice. I've never actually had that one because I prefer a darker roast, and usually the Night Owl blend is my favorite. But it'll wake up your taste buds in the morning, noon, or night. And I actually have a cup right now that I'm drinking. I got in a legendary test blend today, which tastes pretty fantastic. So I think we're going to be moving forward ahead with that pretty soon. So I'm excited about that. But
nice.
Yeah, so all good stuff. And Neil's part of the show and also runs Two Black Eyes podcast. So we're keeping it all in the family here. So if anybody wants to check that out, it's birdscoffeecompany.com, and you can tell them that we sent you.
Nice. In fact, next time I'm in the state, they won't let me import it. I'll have to send it to my...
It all while you're here.
Yeah, you know what I'm just going to have to do is visit you guys. That's what I'm going to have to do.
There you go. There you go. We got my spare bedroom is taken up by the huge BattleTech table, but we can sleep you under the table.
I was gonna say I can sleep on it for good coffee and BattleTech. I'll sleep under the table.
I used to play BattleTech. A guy introduced me to it. I guess we might have still been in high school at the time. I think maybe college, maybe last year in high school. And man, we would set up, so the back bedroom, we had squads of sheets taped up on the wall and 10 boards set up on the floor. You know, we'd leave class, come home, make lunch, and play BattleTech for hours. So much fun.
My the biggest board that we ever had was we did City Tech. Mm-hmm. We did City Tech on both sides, and then what we did is that we put Aerotech in the middle with two planets.
Nice.
So, and then we did invasions back and forth, and that game must have lasted a month. And we were at the end having to fight with urban mechs because that was all that was left.
Yeah.
It was a brutal, it was pretty brutal.
Yeah. We used to use the VTOLs and stuff like that. We never did any of the space stuff, but yeah, we'd set up, city maps and we'd have, hidden bases and you'd write down the hex number and stuff and you'd try to find the base and destroy it and all that.
Wow. Yeah. We had a hard time because the drop ships, you had to try and knock out these drop ships before they landed. And that was pretty intense.
Yeah. Always a lot of fun. All right. So when I was looking, you have a PDF of all the cards that are available. It looks like they're broken in into four separate subsets, or am I looking at that wrong? You had JackMonkey, you had Action Hero, Runaway, Out of Your Depth.
So what we've got, we try to get the cards as balanced as possible. So we've got cards that are going to be entertaining, like Combat Expert. So if you get the Combat Expert card, you're supposed to describe your action, not I swing to hit. You're like, I use my dragon fist and upward cut and add some excitement to it. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to have, the exciting stuff, like Action Hero and Combat Expert, Rage. At the same time, I also wanted to have, how you doing? The card where you're supposed to flirt with an NPC. So I wanted to make sure that they're all nice and balanced. We've got another 20 cards that we want to add in an expansion pack, which is going to even further make that nice and balanced. But for the most part, it's only one deck. It's only one deck, but it's balanced as we can.
Sure. Okay. Cool. And what do people get when they order roll versus roll? What are we looking at here?
So there's a couple ways you can get it. You can get the actual physical deck, and that is through Gamescrafter, and that's going for $14 USD. I always have to remember American dollars. So that's $14, and it's 40 cards and two blank cards. Which, by the way, anybody who fills out one of those blank cards, let me know. Because if I really like it, I will recreate it and give you credit if you let me use it. Not to mention, even if you don't want me to use it, I like to hear what other people are able to create. So it's got two blank decks, or two blank cards in it, and then, of course, the instructions, which is only two-sided. It's one card that's just two-sided. It's that easy to use.
Cool. Very cool.
Then you can get the...
No, go ahead.
Then you can get the print and play version. And the print and play version is a whopping $3 American.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And that's just the PDF version printed out. In fact, the deck that I'm currently using is one that we used from that, and then we laminated it. And we've got some of the models that I've used had signed it. So that's are going to sign it. So it's going to be a specialized deck, because I like the idea that the prototype. I'm actually using the prototype.
Mm-hmm.
And then for those people that are like, ah, screw that, that's just too expensive. We have a $1 version which doesn't have the art. It has all the text, just not the art. And those are available through DriveThruRPG.
You got to get it with the art. The art makes a card. I mean, it has the gist of you know what you're trying to get out of a you know role play scenario. But the art, you know, some of it's humorous, some of it's it really ties everything together.
Thank you. That was kind of what I was working for was to make the art actually appeal to the card and maybe inspire somebody. And of course, there's some Easter eggs in it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I find the same thing with board games, like. You know, you get very basic things. I mean, I did the print and play for War Company by Brandon mm-hmm. Rollins. And, you know, we play through, like, is this going to be good? Is it not? And it's like, you know, plays okay, but it's just, you know, text on little cards. So I went, you know, and I ordered it. And it's great. You know, it's so much better with the art. Like, it's the same game, but it pops so much more when you have that completed thing in front of you.
Well, and that's one of the nice things about actually being the artist is that I have absolute, complete artistic control, which has given me a chance to really expand my artistic skills in this and try to tell my story without it being filtered through somebody else.
Right. Cool. Tom's got a card idea. He's typing in the chat here. Card mm-hmm. for Dirty Fighting.
Ooh. 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 Okay. Have him send me a message when I release the expansion.
Do you hear that, Tom? Send a message.
Which, by the way, anybody who on Twitter, I'm about the most talkative guy possible. I will talk to anyone about role-playing.
And that's actually one of the comments I have here in my notes is that you are super active on Twitter, always engaging. You're always posting questions. You're always looking for conversation. I mean, you're on there the way I wish that I could be on and engage with, you know, people who are listening to the show and all. You are there. It seems like you don't sleep because every time I'm on, you're posting something.
Well, okay. To be fair, I do use Hootsuite to kind of filter out some of those questions. I have a belief with that. I'm not going to hide it. I use Twitter as marketing. Okay, I'm not going to lie about that. But I have a rule, which is to contribute, don't distribute. So I myself only allow myself to plug Roll versus Roll once out of every 15 times I post something. And it's got to be something of value, either showing that, hey, look, I'm a real human, I'm not this big corporation, because look, my hair's messed up and I'm drinking coffee, you know. Too bad it's not Birds of a Feather coffee. Or I'm talking about role-playing. And here's something that I found. I'm learning more about role-playing and being a game master just from listening or reading the text, the comments. Oh my gosh, they're fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been a couple times that I've actually changed my opinion about a few things. Like the whole concept that murder hobos aren't necessarily bad actually came, I learned that from Twitter. From the conversations, because I used to be like, you know, we're going to build a wall to put the, you know, the murder hobos over here, you know, and I've actually changed my opinion of that because working with, you know, these other Twitter guys, they're like, oh, no, you know, murder hobos isn't bad, just, you know, long as they're not screwing it up for everybody else. That's great, you know, because there's nothing. If you can play a sociopath in a group, and have it fit,
right?
You know, so I learned. I've been learning a lot from Twitter. I've been learning a lot, you know, game mastering techniques and role playing techniques, and it's all there because Twitter sphere has got a lot of experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're friends with a lot of the same people, and you know, whatever. And there's a really good group on Twitter that, you know, collectively we're all following, and like you said, a lot of experience, and people are coming from different backgrounds, you know, social, cultural, you know, male, female, like everybody has a different, you know, different place that they're coming from when they play. So yeah, there's a lot of good exchange of information and stuff that can be had there. And certainly a lot of good conversations, and you know, quite a few of which you're starting yourself.
Yeah, I try to start as many conversations as possibly can. And like a good role-playing session, there's been many times I've come back, you know, I'll wake up in the morning and there's like 90 Twitter messages on my phone. I'm like, I'm just scrolling. It's something I started. It's this really great conversation. And I'm like, wow, these two just really went back and forth about this. And that's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely cool. What are you, so you'd mentioned you brought the new Monero book in, so I know you're playing a lot of that. What else are you playing?
So, new Monero, which to be honest, I haven't actually run a game on that yet. Life has been in the way, but I do have some pre-generated characters, all ready to go, because my group, they don't like to roll up characters, they just want to start.
Okay.
So I've got the pre-generated characters ready for them to go. In fact, I think I'm going to break in the new gaming table area with that.
Nice.
Shadowrun. Do a lot of Shadowrun. Do a lot of Starfall, the homebrew. That's actually the big one that everyone wants me to run. Because they're always, the players are like, I want to find out what happens next. Or,
yeah.
You know, because they're most invested in Starfall.
Okay. Has that been the longer running campaign?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because there's 20 years worth of backstory. So I've got NPCs that have been through the game 3 or 4 times, and I've kind of refined them to the point where, okay, I know what they're going to do. They've kind of have their own life now. So that's a lot of fun. The other thing we're doing is a lot of board games. So at our house, the big one that we really enjoy is The Captain is Dead, which is, you can find it on Games Crafter. I backed it on Kickstarter, and that is a lot of fun. We play that a lot. That's a cooperative where you're on a spaceship, and, you know, it's like a Star Trek episode if Picard was to die in the first 5 minutes.
Oh, jeez.
Okay, and the chaos that happens after that. And it's a losing battle. I've played it 15 times and only won, like, 3 times. So it is a lot of fun.
Interesting. Okay. Tom's in the chat. He's excited about a little bit of Shadowrun. So if you're gonna go roll 20, he's up for a game. If you want to expand the universe a little bit.
ooh, yeah. I actually, you know what I need to do? I actually need to play. I'm the once in every other GM. So I need to I actually need to play more.
Mm-hmm.
I've got some. I've got this wolf shaman I need to break out again.
Oh, there you go. So so you wind up finding out that you're the player or the GM for the most part?
Yeah, for the most part. It's my wife likes to say it's because I'm always on stage. yeah, she says that as a player I do okay, but as a GM is where I really excel.
Okay. Some people just have a knack for that, just to, you know, grab a hold and, you know, like work the room and kind of, you know, set the stage. So that's not a bad thing. That's a compliment for sure.
No. No, it's not a bad thing. It's just a game night. It's like, who's going to GM? Everyone looks at me like, duh.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess that gets kind of old. So when you find that you get a chance to actually play in a game, does it sort of like recharge the batteries for you?
It does. In fact, one of the things I've learned is that I try to play systems that I don't know. And if I do play systems like that I know, I'm always trying to play a passive character, support character. This is why I'm always playing clerics. Because I find that it's not my show anymore. And I want to make sure that I contribute to the players the storyline as much as possible. I wasn't always that way. I used to dominate the game board or the game table. Not that everyone didn't have fun, but they didn't have as much fun as they could have.
Okay.
You know, I've learned to be a more passive player.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the things that I worry about, like, you know, when we play, is like for the Rogue Trader game, I'm the face. For the Fear Itself game, with the loss of Eric's character, I kind of migrated to that role. So I like it, but I don't want to feel like I'm the one kind of like running the show sort of thing, you know? So it's hard to kind of find that happy medium. And it's things that we discuss like outside of game, be like, hey, was that a good session for you guys? I didn't step on anybody's toes. Like, you know, you just kind of have to be cognizant of it and, you know, make sure everybody's kind of getting their moment to, you know, do what they want to do.
Well, one of the things that I've done is I have a mental counter, and I make sure that everyone has moved recently before I come up with an idea. And that seems to work out really well, unless we've got a really passive player. And at that point, there's not much I can really do.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you just try to engage them then, you know, if they're just sitting there, because yeah. I try to do that with the rogue, you know, and the rogue trader is very different because like you're the captain, like you're pretty much called the shots. But, you know, I try to, like, engage the other players. Like, oh, hey, Kane, what do you think? Or, you know, Jarnan, what do you think? And try to, you know, pull those characters into the conversation, even if it, you know, if it's a one-on-one conversation, just kind of look and be like, hey, what do you guys think? You know, sort of try to draw them in.
I've been thinking that the next game I get into, if there's one like those, I'm just going to put down the deck of roll versus roll in front of the GM and back off. And if he wants to use it or she wants to use it, great, you know, but it's there. It's there if they want to use it. I find that I almost enjoy, and I've learned this from listening to actual play podcasts, is I enjoy listening as much as I do actually playing.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoy being part of it and seeing the interactions. And I like it. I guess that's one of the things I enjoy about being a GM, is that the best games is when I get everyone all riled up about something and they're planning something, you know, maybe like a leverage heist, or my personal favorite was I got the players, there was a murder caused by artificial intelligence who was going insane because it broke its laws of robotics. So it's freaking out because it didn't want to kill someone, but it did, and it caused the loop. And they're making the decision because they're out in the middle of space, and they're like, okay, do we kill this thing? And it was my turn to go to Taco Bell. So I left, and they were arguing. And now one of the guys speaks German, and his character is in German. So he's always speaking in a German accent. And the other guy was speaking in Japanese. Now, I speak a little bit of Japanese, but not a lot. And he was a lot of fun because he would write what he was saying in subtitles on a whiteboard and hold it up. And it was great. And his Japanese accent is dead on. Is dead on. He spent a lot of time in Japan. So I go to Taco Bell. And I come back, and my neighbor's like, do we need to call the police? And I'm like, what's going on? I go up and I hear, "What? Bakuda!" And I'm like, he's shouting in Japanese. And then I heard something, and the other guy is now yelling at him in German. I'm like, no, they're fine. If it was in English, I'd be worried. But, you know, but because they were in character, both yelling at each other about whether or not an AI has a soul, I had been gone for a half hour.
Yeah. That's awesome.
That was awesome. And so I love try to create those sort of situations. And it doesn't matter if I'm behind the screen or sitting next to the guy, you know, who's, you know, about ready to, you know, jump and slay a goblin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, for sure. That's awesome. We've had, you know, with the, you know, strictly like Google Hangout games where, the, you know, GM be like, you know, "Hey, I'll be right back." And you'd be like, "Okay." So we just, you know, sort of pick it up and start having a conversation. It might be, you know, like a role versus role sort of thing where it's not even what's going on with the game. It should be like, "Oh, you know, when I was sleeping last night, I had this weird dream and whatever." And, you know, GM would be gone for 5 or 10 minutes and come back. And, you know, we're still just role playing on something that might not even really be germane to what's going on. So that's,
well, you know, it's when you have a character that starts doing something that is not what you had planned, but it fits the character, that's when you're truly role-playing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When I first started listening to the Dragon Fisters, and I'd emailed Jesse, the GM, and I'm like, "What the hell is going on with your players? Like, you know, you're just trying to sabotage. Like, I don't understand what they're doing. You know, like, it's just the, like, the worst things." But, you know, character-wise and story-wise and everything was great. But, it, you know, coming from a background of like, all right, let's just kill everything and, you know, we're going to min-max and, you know, we're going to whatever. It was a really interesting new way to experience a game to you know, to have them doing that stuff.
Well, you know, bad decisions are XP goldmine.
Yep.
When you break the concept that I need to win this game and you change it to I just need to survive, and it doesn't need to be epic. It can be by the skin of my teeth, "Oh, I lost." But if you can lose that battle in a way that has style, that the players go, "Holy shit, we just got our ass kicked," you win.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes that's hard for some people to grasp, but the best games, I got my ass kicked.
Yeah, and they're memorable. I mean, that's just as memorable as, you know, killing the, you know, the BBGE, which, you know, you come to expect that for a while, and it sort of fades to the background. You just, "We killed this thing, we killed that thing." But it's like, "Oh, man, you remember that time I was trying to climb the gutter on the building, and it fell, and I fell on the ground?" Like, you just remember that forever.
Well, and that's the thing, is that the best role-playing will make a good story 10 years from now. Mm-hmm. And "I killed a skeleton" isn't a great story. "I killed a skeleton by beating him with a petrified familiar cat" is a great story.
Right. Right.
I'll tell you that one later. It was the Club of Many Claws.
Yeah. That's cool. But, and like you were saying with podcasting, like at the height of my podcast listening, I probably listened to, you know, 20 or so podcasts, and it, you know, you're sort of like, you know, whatever the basketball expression is, the 12th man on the bench or whatever, like, you know, you a good podcast, you feel like you have a virtual seat at the table. So you're in on the inside jokes, and, you know, you kind of follow what's going on with the story, and you get to learn the character. So you feel like you're a part of that. And especially for people who can't game, don't have a group, geographically they're isolated, podcasts are just a wonderful way to be able to experience that camaraderie.
Yeah. Well, it's like Steamrollers. Have you listened to Steamrollers Adventure Podcast?
I haven't, no.
Okay. Definitely do. Start from the very beginning, because I actually found myself shouting in the car going, "No, you can't do that."
All right, I have to check that out.
Yeah, Steamrollers Adventure Podcast is good. let's see, the other one I got addicted to is the archive, or the Arcology podcast, which is Shadowrun. And I've been listening very closely on what's happening with Tiny. I need to catch up, but I've been listening very closely to that. And then the other one I got into was it's a Numenera long shot by
Vandible.
Vandible, yes.
Friend of the
yes,
show.
Yes, I've been loving that one. Yes. I've been loving them. They're absolutely hilarious. Just awesome.
They're wonderful, wonderful role players. I've been listening to them for probably, I don't know, it's got to be 8 or 9 years, however long they've been doing it. They were one of the first ones I started listening to, and they're just wonderful, wonderful players.
Another good one that I just discovered was Dice for Brains.
I haven't heard of that.
Just discovered them. They're also really good. I was wondering, at first when I was listening to them, like, they've got to be actors. They've got to be thespians, because the role playing on it is just boom, 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 and then you're like, what? Oh yeah, they're rolling dice. Okay.
Right. Yeah. When you find a good podcast, that's, you know, you want to stick with it. You know, you see the players grow and the characters grow, and you know, if they jump around, like Fandible plays, you know, a bunch of different systems. The long shot being, you know, sort of the break from the norm, where they have this one, you know, long campaign that they're playing now. And yeah, it's been a lot of fun to listen to.
Well, that's actually in the plans for us. We're gonna take Starfall. We're gonna be using Roll versus Roll with it, and we're currently talking about using either the D6 or the Cypher system. And so we're gonna start an actual play podcast, and that's probably a good 2 months off. Because, you know, I first got to get away from boxes and figure out where I put my microphones.
Right.
But, or my dice would be good.
Yeah, dice are helpful. Oh my God, I don't know why my phone is jingling, because... let me turn that down. No, I want to power it off. Okay, technical difficulties. I put it on Do Not Disturb. I don't know why it's jingling. Well, we happen to have a podcast network. I'll just throw that out there.
Okay. Well, you know, I will definitely once we do get something going, because I'd like to have at least a couple episodes in the can first before I publish or start promoting. I will definitely hit you up for that.
All right. Cool. Definitely something that we can discuss off air for sure. all right. So, what other projects do you have coming up? What other exciting things do you have going on?
So, after we're done with Roll versus Roll, we actually had a project called Invoke, and Invoke is a card game which is not your typical spell casting game, because you actually have to build the components of the spell. Hmm. So the idea is that you're fighting over these stones. And in order to steal a stone from someone else, you cast a card that says target stone, and then move left 4 paces, and now it moves four players over to your pile. And then that person could say, interrupt, or target current spell, move left 4 spaces, which now makes it so it reflects back on you, and now they get your stone. And it's, we've been playtesting it for about 4 or 5 years. We were gonna do a Kickstarter first with that, but we decided that we're gonna use Roll versus Roll as a test bed first. And I tell you, every time we playtest it, some player comes up with a combination of cards that I had no idea could be possible, and then had to think, yeah, that would work. So it's It's not your normal spell casting game. We use spells because that's a popular concept, but we've been also thinking about reskinning it for hacking, because it is more of a programming language, really. And it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. You should start seeing us talking about that probably August.
Okay. Cool. Or maybe sooner now, since you've got a little bit more time.
Maybe sooner now. Yeah, sooner now. We already have half the artwork done. So it's just a matter of finishing up the playtesting, make sure the rules are really easy to understand. I want to do some blind playtesting, where playtesting is where we just send a print and play and the instructions, and we just get feedback. Or I take it to a convention, I give them the deck, the instructions, and then I watch them and see where they go, oh, I don't quite understand this rule, so I can tweak them.
Right. Go ahead.
I'm going.
I was going to ask, you've mentioned conventions. What's the convention scene like down in Australia there?
You know how there's always a convention going somewhere, you know, in the States?
No.
There's like two. There's one in 2 weeks, which I'm going to miss. Or I think it's next week, which I'm going to miss. And then there's another one, which is in Melbourne once a year, called PAX, which is pretty awesome. And there's smaller stuff, but it's not as often.
Okay. Yeah, I wonder. PAX just added another convention here, Unplugged, in Philadelphia, which is going to be more just board games and tabletop, because their normal shtick is more video games and that kind of thing.
Yeah, I think there needs to be more of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's tons of options here for sure. We're actually heading up to Necronomicon in August up in Providence, Rhode Island, which is a Lovecraftian convention. A little bit more of a literary bent than, you know, gaming per se, but it's a fun time. We went 2 years ago. They do it every 2 years, and that's a really fun convention. So, but you were talking about Invoke. I didn't mean to cut you off.
Oh no, actually that was it about Invoke. It's
okay.
The interesting part about that Kickstarter is that the original artwork, the hand painted paintings for the artwork, is going to be available as not a stretch goal, but one of the packages.
Cool.
Pledge level. Yeah. So if someone pledges the maximum amount, they will actually get a canvas painting of the original artwork. So
that's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. That's there will be a limited amount because we've only got like 20 cards. So.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I was looking at some of the art as I was going through and doing my research. The snail one that was featured, is
with the
cool.
Runes.
It's got the runes on the shell. Yeah, it's really neat. Nice
Thank
color
you.
Palette,
yeah,
too. The whole visually is very appealing.
Thank you. Thank you. That's one of the things that I want to start doing is doing art for other games. And in order to do that, I have to put my best foot forward. And one of the things that doing these designs have challenged me as an artist, because I'm like, I'm assigning my name to this in every shape and form. Shit, I gotta up my game.
Right. Well, and the nice thing for you, you know, doing your own games and being an artist, is you cut out such a huge chunk of, you know, potential Kickstarter costs, because you can do it yourself.
Well, and one of the things is that my wife is a copyright lawyer, so we have a rule, and that is the artist always gets paid. And we believe in that all the way through. So if someone provides art for some of our future games, they're going to get paid. It's mm-hmm. just the way it is.
Sure, sure.
And because her entire education is based on making sure that those artists get paid.
Right.
And so we're like, you know, let's just make sure we do it right from the very beginning. And it is nice. It is nice that there isn't that cost, because the idea of going and having someone spend hours and hours, like that snail took me 6 hours to do. That's 6 hours out of my life, which took me years to develop to be able to do that only within 6 hours. So that's a lot of work. And the idea that I might work for someone else and not get paid is just scary. So why would we want to do it for someone else?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Well, that's cool.
It's nice. It's nice being able to just pick up my own brush and just do it.
Right. Well, then the flip side of that is, since the artist gets paid, are you budgeting out an art budget as you're moving forward, thinking, you know, of Kickstarter to, you know, pay the artist, who is yourself?
So one of the things that we have to do is, based on production time, is that I actually now have to clock in every morning when I walk into the studio and I pick up a brush. I have to clock in now. My wife's requiring me to clock in so we can get an idea of what the cost is.
Sure.
Which now means I can't, when I'm clocked in, I actually can't goof around and, you know, hey, let's see what Twitter's going on. Oh, hey, look, what's Facebook? Okay. Hey, look, here's a new podcast. Let me download everything and just pay attention to that for a while. I can't do that anymore.
Right. You know? So she's taking all the fun out of everything.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. My wife can make a my wife, she's a blast. She can make a courtroom sound like a carnival. She's pretty awesome with that. She's pretty good at injecting fun into things.
Well, a courtroom is kind of like a carnival.
Yeah.
At least they are here. I don't know about down there.
We have wigs.
Oh, there you go. That's awesome.
Yeah. There's wigs. So,
cool. All right. I'm just about out here. We're running. Okay. We're pushing about an hour and a half, but we do have our final five here. So I'll run you through those questions.
Okay.
I know you're familiar with these, so we'll just jump right in. The first one is Star Trek or Star Wars?
Oh, okay. So my first bit of, I've seen every Star Wars film in the theater with the original showing. Okay. Every single one of them. In fact, I was told as a child, Chewbacca scared me. I don't know. I mean, I was young enough to think Ewoks were cool. Okay. So that kind of gives you an idea how young I was, but, So I would say that Star Wars actually kicked off the love for it. That said, I will binge watch Star Trek.
Okay. No, that's fair. I saw Star Trek, or my parents, I guess, wanted to see it and drugged my, you know, 5-year-old self along. I remember bits and pieces of seeing it in the theater with the speaker hanging in the window and everything and just being amazed by all that stuff. So yeah, I'm nice. In the same boat. But before we continue, Tom wants to know whether or not you guys have kangaroo judges with little wigs.
No. We have kangaroo burgers. Those are really good.
I have never had kangaroo. I've had some weird shit, but never kangaroo.
Kangaroo is really good. The closest equivalent is buffalo.
Okay, I've had buffalo before.
And by the way, a kangaroo can kill you. Just letting you know. They look cute and cuddly. They can kill you.
Well, they get you with their feet, right? I mean, they'll kick the shit out of you. Literally.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Tabletop or video games?
Tabletop. I love video games, but it's, for me, I'm a tech. I spend all of my time in front of screens. I try to avoid that as much as I possibly can. So. Mm-hmm.
Did you do video games as you were, younger?
Yeah. I did my whole, addictive gaming thing. I used to, sell computers, and I had, the Alienware, beast computer, and, did my stint in WoW. Mm-hmm. But it's, the problem is, as an artist, time is my problem. I need lots of that.
Sure.
And when I'm not, if there's not a paintbrush in my hand, it can just really suck the life out of me, you know? At least with board games and RPGs, there's at least a beginning and an ending within a reasonable amount of time. Whereas video games, I have very strict rules. Like, I play XCOM on my phone on the train. That's it.
Sure.
I might do it to wind down at home a little bit, but I try to limit that as much as possible.
I used to do stuff on the phone, and I've just, it sucked up so much time, because every time I would sit down somewhere, I would grab the phone and I'd start dicking around, and I'm like, you know what? No apps on the phone. I can't, because like you said, it just sucks so much time away. You know, you could be doing 100 other things than playing, Candy Crush or whatever.
Yeah, well, it's like I looked at my friend's Steam, his Steam account, and I realized, holy shit, that's four times the amount of the budget I had in hours I had for Roll versus Roll and all the expansions I could possibly think of. And that was just League of Legends. And I'm thinking, oh, what could I do with that much time?
Mm-hmm.
I unfortunately now have that much time, but you know.
Sure. All right. DC or Marvel?
Okay. I like them both. For the comics, I tend to like DC. And I like the DC TV series. I'm waiting for them to figure out this whole cinematic thing.
Yeah, they're not doing well.
No. And what it is that they've taken, they assume that big names and look, we've got a ensemble of all of these characters, and we're just going to tease you that there's enough backstory behind them. Like, I think Suicide Squad would have been amazing if it was another 3 hours long.
Okay.
Because you can see that there's more story to each of the characters. They just never got around to it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would be a fantastic, HBO series.
Yeah, I could see that.
They're just not taking the time to tell the story. And that's, it's all about the story.
Right. Well, as a comic, right? Yeah, I mean, that's what you want to get something to sink your teeth into, where Hollywood is just like explosions, action, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's, CGI does not a movie make.
Ask George Lucas.
Yes.
Yeah. Those are movies we won't talk about.
No.
All right. Sci-fi or fantasy?
Sci-fi. I do enjoy my fantasy, but I've actually tried GMing fantasy, and it just does not click with me. Where sci-fi, I can come up with great ideas all day. Fantasy just kind of... I can do like the hybrid, like Numenera, which is science fantasy, and I can do Shadowrun, which is, the tech fantasy kind of stuff, dark fantasy, urban fantasy, but I can't do full fantasy, from a GM standpoint. I make a badass cleric. I love that, but given my chance, given the choice, I would go sci-fi.
Okay. Does that carry over to books and stuff as well, or strictly more like a video game or a board game, RPG? Jesus.
I don't know. I do enjoy a good fantasy, so it's, I'll take what I can get. I'm not gonna bitch. It's like sushi or pizza. Oh darn.
Yeah. I gotcha. All right. And if you could have one superpower, what would it be?
To speak any language.
Okay.
I've been learning how to speak Japanese for quite some time. I'm at the point now where I can make friends. I'm now at the level of being a polite tourist. At times, I have to be careful that my pronunciation is getting pretty good to the point where I make someone think my vocabulary is much larger than it actually is, which kind of creates some embarrassing situations. But I've really, really enjoyed learning the language. I've enjoyed learning that. And just the language gives you a different insight on a culture. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of power with words. And I guess this is why I'm a GM, is because I truly believe in that. I would just speak multiple languages. That there's just a lot of cool people out there, and a language barrier. You know, I grew up in a print shop, and the guy who was he worked next door was it's the wife calling. Let's just say that he was a doctor in Mexico, but couldn't practice in the States. So here was a brilliant guy. He just had bad English. So with that said, my wife is calling. I do need to go.
All right. Thank you for coming on. We appreciate you coming in and hanging out. And we're glad to help to promote Role versus Role and, get you out there and get that on people's tables.
You know, that would be a lot of fun. In fact, you know, the more that I can get on other people's tables, the more I can start producing other things, which might be even cooler.
Cool. Oh,
okay, I gotta get that one.
All right.
See you later.
See ya.
Okay.
All right, there goes Kevin, and we appreciate him having him on. We're gonna throw Tom's two cents in there. Any superpower he would have would be magnetism. So that's an interesting one we haven't heard before. So thank you, Tom. Glad to have you in the live chat again. Tom's becoming our stalwart companion here in the live chat, so we appreciate that. I'll give out all of our details here. All the details for Kevin will be in the show notes for sure. But you can find this and all of our awesome content at legendsoftabletop.com. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, you can reach out to us at legendsoftabletop@gmail.com. Our main feed is over at SoundCloud, but we're on iTunes and Player FM and all those various places. Whatever your favorite podcatcher is, you can get us through there. We're on Tumblr and Instagram and Facebook and all that kind of stuff. You go hit all the like buttons and subscribe and all those things. That's fantastic. Any reviews that you could leave are greatly appreciated. That helps us out a ton. We appreciate you checking this out, and we'll catch you next time.